Erickson got trained under Anna Freud, who was the daughter of Sigmund Freud. We'll talk more about that and them later. He then came up with a life stage developmental pattern. So we've talked about several stages already, and we'll talk about a couple more after this. And he took the first five stages, which were the entire theory for Freud, of what Freud called psychosexual development. And we'll talk about that in the personality chapter in depth. But what he did was he looked at it more from a social point of view, more from an ego development point of view, less about the sexual forces, which would be libido for Freud, and more on just your experience in the world leading to certain kinds of opportunities or outcomes. The first year for Erickson is the oral stage for Freud. Predictability of the world is what you're after. Can you trust this world? Now, it's not trust in the sense that you and I talk about it with adult language and adult concepts. It's just, is the world responsive to you as an infant because you got needs? You start crying, does somebody come? If you're hungry, do they feed you? If you're in your own waste products, do they clean you? If you're cold, do they swaddle you, right? If you're in need, does the world come to your aid? If it does, it comes in the form of a parent usually, then you learn that the world is a trusting place. But for kids who get a lot of abuse or a lot of neglect, they learn that the world is not a place that you can trust. It will promote mistrust in the world, not, again, consciously, cognitively, but that's the experience, that the world doesn't respond in the way you need it to, when you need it to. And what you see is polarities here, two poles. Of course, I hope you recognize from our talks of statistics and normal curves, right? It's very rare that you're going to get somebody on one extreme or the other. Most of us are toward the middle and we lean one way or we lean another. We're not so extreme, but the extremes exist. The next stage, we're looking at that toddlerhood, autonomy versus shame, and one of the hallmark accomplishments. Now, what is the toddler doing? The toddler is experimenting with being an independent self in the world, trying to get what it wants. I want a cookie. Can't have a cookie. Well, that's, you get punished if you say that, right? So you start to learn, and you're trying to assert yourself. Territoriality is part of this, but one of the hallmarks is also toilet training. Toilet training is a big deal, right? Because it's a mark of independence. People don't care if you poop and pee in your pants if you're 6 months old. They may even go, would you make a little poopy in your pants? That's cute. Well, it ain't cute when you're three. Now it's a mess that has to be cleaned up, and we want you to do it yourself. Well, kids who are too young don't have sphincter control. They don't control their waste elimination. It comes out when it comes out. But as they grow older, the world starts expecting them to do that, to develop the skills. Well, in the case where we all make mistakes, all of us could still mess our pants when you get really, really sick, right? Or older, right? You get this kid who's trying to master going to the bathroom on their own initiative at the right time. And if you encourage that, oh, you made a mistake. That's okay. That's okay. We'll clean it up. You know, you got on those big boy pull-up pants, right? You're doing good. We'll get you there. Then you're getting the support from the environment that makes you feel autonomy when you accomplish it. Look, I did it. Awesome. Look at you go. Now I don't have to clean it up because you put it in the right place yourself. Autonomy. But if you have a kid who struggles with it, again, you messed up again. Oh, now I got to clean up. This smells terrible. Look at you. Why don't you learn how to do this? 2.5, by golly. That kid gets punishment as the experience, right? And is made to feel ashamed for not accomplishing it. So now you got kind of a trend that starts to develop, and what you see is the trends extend. Initiative versus guilt. Now I got a kid who's developing. As they develop, if they've got a trust of the world, they start to develop autonomy, they might take initiative. Take initiative to do what? Who does anything for? They play. In our world, where we now have childhood and they don't have to go out milking cows immediately as soon as they're able to do it, they play. And are they encouraged in that play? I love dinosaurs. I love you know, dolls, whatever. If they're encouraged, then the world is saying that it's appropriate for them to take initiative. The kid brings you another dinosaur for the 15 millionth time, and you go, that's awesome. Even though you've seen it before, you're encouraging the kid to take initiative, right? But if you don't have time for the kid, come on now, I ain't got time for this. Go play over there. I seen that dinosaur. Then you're telling them that they shouldn't be taking initiative. That's not going to get rewarded. They should feel guilt for taking up the time of the parent. Industry then versus inferiority. Now we're moving up into this pre-puberty area where we send them to schooling, formal schooling. Formal schooling then requires you do a lot of work. Well, if you've already got this basis of the world's trustworthy, I got a lot of autonomy, I get a lot of support for taking initiative, then when I try out my schoolwork and I don't do well, I'm going to get encouraged and I'm going to figure it out. I'm going to overcome the obstacles and persist versus world's mistrustful. I feel like a shameful person. I'm not very good at anything, so I don't expect to do well in school. And that's exactly what we thought, because look at you. You couldn't get toilet training right. How are you ever going to get the times tables down? Identity versus confusion is your adolescence phase. Who am I? Well, nobody really knows up in adolescence, but they have a greater or lesser sense of it. A lot of people will try out different types of identity, different kinds of music, et cetera, et cetera. Like that music right there. Which means it's time to go, y'all. Y'all have a great, great weekend. Be safe, and I'll see you all Monday. As I said before, the first five stages map right onto Freud's psychosexual stages of development, which we will talk about when we get to the personality chapter. Change the whole landscape of how people saw people to have Freud come onto the scene. Freud being off the mark, perhaps, on a number of his own points, as we find data did not support some of them. In other cases, there's no refutation because it's not operationalizable. We saw other people modify it, other people who would be called psychodynamic in their orientation, and that would include Erik Erikson, who trained under Anna Freud, the daughter of Sigmund Freud, and he changed these. So it wasn't the psychosexual stage of development. He said these are the stages that all people go through. They tend to have a social component to them, and they are about figuring out who you are, your ego identity. And so he kept the first five, but he changed what was the outcome variable so that we're really looking at early on in life, as we already said and talked about the other day, trust versus mistrust. Does the world respond to me when I have needs? If so, I trust. If not, I mistrust. Toilet training era, trying to establish will, trying to establish territory, who's in charge, parents or the kid, got autonomy versus shame, initiative versus guilt in that kind of young childhood phase, and then we move into school, industry versus inferiority, and we left off in adolescence when we talked about music. People will experiment with different identities in adolescence as part of figuring out who you are, but if you come into it with a pretty solid sense of self, you don't have too much confusion. You experiment, perhaps, but from a solid sense of who you are versus somebody who doesn't really know who they are. Then we move through that, and we get into early adulthood, which for Erikson is about relationship building. There's different kinds of relationships. The critical one that he would look at is the mating relationship or the love relationship. So there's an intimate relationship there. But there's other kinds of intimacies, not just sexual intimacies. Intimacy is about trusting people. It's about being able to reveal your secrets, your fears, your desires to somebody else, and that somebody else is trustworthy, and you think they'll keep that in confidence, and vice versa. So it's about negotiating relationships, which might be work relationships, friendships, family relationships, etc. And then as we move through that, we're into our career years. Those careers might be any number of things. It might be homemaking, it might be in an industry, it might be in a trade, but what you're doing is essentially generating for you and those around you, if you are in the positive pole of this stage, the generativity, where you're now getting not only for yourself, but maybe for your family, maybe for your friends, maybe you work and volunteer at church or at a soup kitchen, or you do things that benefit other people because you have this energy and you have this expression of self that allows you to generate for others, versus the flip side of that being self-absorbed, looking out for other people because you know they can't be trusted. The world's a mean place. You better get yours before they get you. Might have to do a little backstabbing to get what you want, but it leads you to a course of action where you're not very socially involved because people don't feel like that they can trust you or that you're a good person. And then finally, you get to the last stage because he says you don't stop developing. You develop all the way through the end. All the way through the stages that lead us right up to death. And when you're at the end phase, after you've retired and after you get to the part where maybe your health is deteriorating, you can look back on life. And what you see is a trend that can develop. If the world is trusting and people are supportive, you develop a sense of autonomy, which allows you to take initiative. If that's supported, you become industrious. If that's supported, you have a sense of identity. If that's supported, you can become more intimate because you have a good foundation for knowing who you are and who you can trust. And if that's the case, then you can form relationships that allow you to be generative throughout your lifetime. And you get to the end of it all, on the deathbed, you look back with integrity. You say, well, you know, I had a pretty good life. I don't have absence of regrets. Surely everybody has regrets and things they wish they'd done differently, but you can look back on it with a sense of pride that you did the best you could with what you had when you had to, and you got people around you because you've built these relationships, so you're not alone, and you can look back on it with satisfaction. Versus if the world was a mean world to you and it didn't respond when you were an infant, didn't give you what you needed, it was either neglectful or abusive, for example, it might lead you to a period where you're developing a sense of shame, which leads you to a sense of guilt, making you feel inferior, leading you to some confusion about your role in the world. Tend to be isolated, which would make you more self-absorbed. And you get to the end of it, where are the people that are surrounding you loving? Well, they're not there because you didn't form those relationships, because you didn't put yourself out there, because you didn't think you could trust other people, because the world was a place that you found was punishing and something to be guarded against. So you can see that these are trends, and nobody's usually extremely here or extremely there. If we threw a normal distribution on top of those poles, we see very few people at extreme ends of this. Most people will be toward the middle, leaning one way or the other. And through life events or your own self-initiated change, you might be able to change the course of action for the positive or for the negative, depending on what's happening in your life and what your own goals might be. Now, for your test, like I said, you might want to know stage 8 real well for your items. Ha! See how I do you if you come on in this. Thank you for being here. People say, what's retrospective? If you look back upon your life retrospectively, it is to examine its past, right? And if you look back retrospectively at stage 8, the last stages, if things went generally well for you, you'll have a sense of integrity, a sense of satisfaction. And if they didn't go well for you, you have a sense of despair. Right? Bitterness is a possibility. People, you know people who get to the end of life and they got a lot of bitterness. For Erickson, that's what happened. The world shaped them in that way.